Now, a closer look.
A sleepy morning, we're out in the boondocks. Stories being told on the red clay.
Today's segment is titled Valentine Stories, especially for food and music lovers. As these Italian mandolins were trying to say, it's now or never. A call for romance is in the air, for tomorrow is Valentine's Day. So, perhaps you shrug your shoulders saying, okay, no big deal, because here it's basically just another day. But in America, according to the National Restaurant Association, Valentine's Day is the second busiest day of the year, second only to Mother's Day, of course. For the person in pursuit of romance, flowers will likely be a standard offering tomorrow, with jewelry and clothing ranking nearly neck and neck, just above the chocolates and the perfume. In fact, American consumers spent an estimated $20 billion on this day alone last year, since one in two people celebrated Valentine's Day, according to the National Retail Federation. So you may be asking, what's the number one pick on the sweetheart's list for tomorrow? It's dinner out at their favorite romantic ristorante.
Like a big pizza pie, oh, that's amore. When the stars make you shine like you've had too much wine, you're in love. When you are in a dream, but you know you're not dreaming, signore. Excuse me, but you see, back in old Napoli, oh, that's amore.
When the moon hits your eye like a big pizza pie, that's amore. Personally, I think there's something genetically designed in the Italian genes that naturally know how to intertwine food with love. Or perhaps it's because Valentine's Day is an old tradition from the Roman Empire. Either way, growing up in an Italian family, food, and I mean great food and plenty of it, is such a staple that it's always around, and because it's the basis of every celebration, well, then Cupido, at least that's what he's called when he's around Italians, has plenty to nibble on from the cucina italiana for further advancing his romantic purposes. When the world seems to shine like you've had too much wine, that's amore. And what could be more romantic than adding music to the food and wine? Surely then one can be legitimately tipsy from pursuing or being pursued by this art of L-O-V-E.
At night. got this feeling just can't be right. And I'm telling ya, it's too late to turn back now. I believe I'm falling in love. It's too late to turn back now.
Over the years, fortunately, I've been to many fine dining restaurants, and so I took a moment to stop and reflect upon the most romantic place I could think of, which put together the perfect concoction for romantic intoxication. And what came to mind was Roberts of Charleston. Let's go now and speak with the singing chef himself, who entertained so many romantic sweethearts for decades. On the phone, I have Chef Robert Dixon. You graduated from the Culinary Institute of America over 5 decades ago when it was originally located in New Haven, Connecticut. But your original cooking teacher was your Italian mom. Is that true?
Oh, yes. She inspired me. She learned from her family.
Some years ago, you retired from what I've seen and experienced as the most romantic dinner destination in the heart of Charleston, South Carolina. You did that for over 3 decades, where couples flocked to your East Bay Street restaurant called Roberts of Charleston to be wined, dined, and serenaded. It was like Valentine's Day every day there.
It really was. It was a very romantic, small, no room sat more than 40, 45 people. So it was very intimate. And what made it so was the music. Not every restaurant has music. I created music the night I opened. I sang solo pieces from Broadway and opera with a pianist, accompanist.
Food, glorious food. I'm anxious to serve you 3 banquets a day. I'll do my best.
Bravo, bravissimo. Now, since this show is about interesting, funny, and memorable Valentine stories, I know that you must have a few. What comes to mind?
One of our first Valentine's days was my daughter's. She went to an all-girls school, and we invited her whole class, probably 2 classes, how many there were of
what?
That grade, probably 3rd or 4th grade. Yeah, so we had about 40 children. I made spinach quiche, which was very fashionable in the 1970s, and we had chocolate mousse for dessert. They never forgot about it. I got the most wonderful notes. We kept them for years, individual notes from the little girls and even from the parents. And it's still mentioned today. This town is the same size, of course, but on occasion I see some of the those daughters are in their 40s now, late 40s, and they say, we'll never forget. Well, we remember the Valentine's lunch you had us to, and I sang for them, and so it was very memorable for them.
Amazing. Any baking, any rings and things and desserts?
Some men would call ahead. You could tell they were so nervous. They just didn't know how to go about this. And I didn't know either when I first started. We had to figure it out together. But the most usual was that, and the safest, they would deliver the ring that afternoon. I'd keep it on a high shelf or maybe in my pocket. Some Valentines, we had 2 of these happen a night where people would get engaged. Then we would slip the ring, however they wanted, in the case or whatever, in the bread basket. I remember it was fairly successful, except one time the basket got to the wrong table. Well, it didn't get to the right table because we didn't know what table it got to. And we had to recollect all the bread baskets And there we found it, so relieved. Yeah, and he was anxious to do it. He didn't know it wasn't in there, and we caught it just in time. And I thought, oh, if he gave her that bread basket and offered her the bread and was holding it there, and there was no ring, she would have thought he was crazy.
Amazing. Any other stories?
Well, people repeated that year for many years. They would call ahead, months ahead, and say, we want to come back. We want the same table. Yeah, it was a very special. And eventually, we opened two nights in a row, especially if it's on a weekend. We'd call Valentine's Day, and then we'd either open the day before or the day after.
Nice.
Because we couldn't fit them all, and even that, we had a wait list beyond that. So,
Julia Child, who I think you know, said it like this: people who love to eat are always the best people. What do you think of that?
Very simply put. Yeah, I believe in that. And another nice story about Julia, what would have been her 100th birthday in 2013, I was asked to do a talk about her at our library. To gather the material, I happened to research on the internet and found that Julia and Paul gave their arts and letters to Radcliffe College in Cambridge, Mass. And so I called the college, and we found that Julia was the type of person, when she wrote to you, she made a copy and sent you, of course, the original. But me, as I replied, never thought that I would make a copy of something, a letter I'd send back. But she had copies on both sides.
Wow.
And it amounted to 150 pieces of letters over 40 years that I have known her.
Amazing. As the saying goes, the way to a man or a woman's heart is through their stomach. Do you have any Valentine's tips for our listeners for romancing their loved one through food, glorious food and song?
Well, oysters. You have to eat oysters on Valentine's
Day.
And champagne. I would make most of the dishes warm. Even the dessert, a souffle on Valentine's Day, is really special.
Well, you know Charles Schulz, the creator of Peanuts. He said it like this: all you need is love, but a little chocolate now and then doesn't hurt. Robert,
yeah.
I thank you from the bottom of my heart for taking time to speak with me and our listeners on Valentine's Day, and we send heart-shaped wishes to you and yours.
Oh, thank you.
You see, my mama, she told me, don't worry about your side. Because boys like a little more booty to hold at night. You know I won't be no stick figure, silicone Barbie doll. So if that's what you're into, then go ahead and move along.
I'm all about that bass, about that bass, no treble. I'm all about that bass, about that bass, no treble. I'm all about that bass, about that bass, no treble. I'm all about that bass, about that bass. I'm all about that bass, about that bass, no treble. I'm all about that bass, about that bass, no treble. I'm all about that bass, about that bass, no treble. I'm all about that bass.
Since so many are intrigued by a restaurant with an incredible view, I found one such restaurant perched high up on the Sierra Nevada mountain range, where the eagles soar, so to speak. Let's go now and speak with the executive chef who's been managing this romantic paradise for more than a decade. On the phone, I have a chef from the high altitudes of Lake Tahoe, Nevada, Chef Bill Marchetti. I understand that you're a graduate from the Johnson & Wales University in Providence, Rhode Island.
Yes, I am.
That happened a few decades ago, but I think that your original cooking instructors were probably your Sicilian and Russian grandmothers. Is that true?
That's true, Dan. They were both immigrants from a faraway land.
they probably had their secret ingredients of plenty of amore, plenty of love.
This is true. Every weekend we would go there and everything was prepared from scratch, you know. The pizza, the pasta was rolled out by hand, no machines back then in the day. And it's quite a bit of labor and effort put into it. And all the kids usually assisted. So that's kind of what turned me on and sparked my passion for cooking.
Now, you've cooked a lot of great foods and for a lot of interesting people, including people that not only loved great food, but also loved singing too, like Old Blue Eyes, Frankie Sinatra, and Sammy Davis Jr. Is that true?
Yes. Back in the day, the Rat Pack would perform in Lake Tahoe when we had celebrity headliners, also Dean Martin.
And you're a personal chef and caterer and chef in Tahoe. And you've been operating a very successful cocktail lounge and event venue called the Eagle's Nest. How long have you been doing that?
I've been in business with that enterprise for the last 14 years.
Wow. Well, you know that here in Bavaria, we've got what might be thought of as the original Eagle's Nest. And it sits at an altitude of a little over 6,000 feet. That's 1,834 meters. Do you know what the elevation is of your Eagle's Nest in State Line, Nevada?
Absolutely. We're located at an altitude of 7,700 feet. We are adjacent to the Heavenly Valley ski area, and hopefully when people hear the term Eagle's Nest, it's a better word association than the one that they had in Germany.
Yes, I know. And it sounds like your place is majestically high above the city lights.
Sit and hold each other while listening to our favorite tune. A half-hidden moon, a love seems to whisper to show.
I think food and love are interwoven. During your culinary career, have you ever been asked to bake an engagement ring for Valentine's Day into a strawberry mousse cake or a chocolate gâteau?
You know, we've never baked a ring into anything, but the more common occurrence, and this has happened on more than one occasion, we've been requested to place the ring into the bread basket. So when the server brought out the rolls or the bread, the young lady would peel back the napkin and find her ring. We've also been asked to put it into a champagne glass, and we had on one occasion the lady who was presented with the ring ended up chipping her tooth on it when she went to take the last sip. She wasn't aware of that. So,
ouch.
I think everyone agreed to the proposal that I know of. I don't think there were any
nose
on the offer.
Nice.
But one of my favorite stories is, it's not so much of the proposal, but relating to a Valentine's Day incident. A friend of mine, many years ago, decided to take his significant other out for dinner. So he picks her up. He's pulled out all the stops. He's got reservations at the finest restaurant in town, which is our place. He's got flowers waiting for her on the table. And to top it all off, he decides to dress like Cupid. So he's wearing a pink leotard with a wreath of flowers around his head, complete with wings, a tutu, ballet slippers, and a bow and arrow. En route to the restaurant, evidently they become embroiled in a little bit of a disagreement. He becomes distracted from what he's doing and turns down a one-way street the wrong way. So as he's driving down the road, there happens to be a police officer heading towards him in the opposite direction. So he gets pulled over. They run his license, and evidently he's got a warrant out for some unpaid parking tickets. So he's taken into custody, and for some reason he said something that didn't really quite appeal to the police officer. So they throw him into general population, And instead of putting him into a jumpsuit, they make him stay in the Cupid outfit. He was able to take the wings off, I believe, and leave the bow and arrow at the desk. So now he's in general population with, you know, whoever else happens to be in there. He said it was a pretty crowded evening. And he's wearing a pink leotard with a tutu, ballet slippers, and a wreath of flowers around his head, which he proceeded to spend the next 24 hours in there until he was able to be bailed out. Evidently, his girlfriend was not up to the task of bailing him out. That kind of reminds one of my favorite Valentine stories of all time. Another Valentine story I do have for you is some dear friends of mine were married, it'll be 25 years ago this Valentine's Day, my friends Kevin and Joy. So I was asked to be their best man. They flew out here from Delaware and eloped. So it was kind of a non-formal, casual setting. It was held on the beach. Her maid of honor was not able to attend because there was a blizzard that weekend. And wow. So I also filled in as her maid of honor and the ring bearer. So I ordered a cake for them at a local bakery. And when they asked me what name I wanted on there, I said, Kevin and Joy. They, in turn, kind of mixed up the pronunciations, so it came out as Calvin and Judy. So we still joke about it, but on their return flight home, they were talking to the flight attendant, and they told them the whole story about the cake, Kevin and Judy, Julie being translated into Calvin and Julie. So as they were about to land, the pilot announced on the intercom system that he would like to congratulate Calvin and Julie on their recent wedding. And they got a big round of applause from other passengers on the plane. So 25 years later, they're still going strong. Calvin and Julie.
Sounds good. Sounds like stories like that made a everlasting bond. You know, George Bernard Shaw said it like this: there is no love sincerer than the love of food.
This is true. That rounds out the whole package.
Chef Bill, I thank you from the bottom of my heart, and may this Valentine's Day have some kind of great, harmonious, or humorous story waiting for you. Happy Valentine's Day to you and your whole staff.
All right, Dan. Happy Valentine's Day. Long come to do.
Once remember overhearing a couple of teenagers crafting their scheming plans, and it went something like this. If I ever worked in a restaurant on Valentine's Day, I'd put a fake engagement ring in every girl's drink. The funny thing about Valentine's Day is it reflects like a mirror the funny things which can happen during this amateur hour romantic quest. Whether or not one wants to fan out his colorful plumage in an auspicious display, acting like a peacock, with hopes to attract some attention, well, this is something each will need to decide on their very own. There's little doubt, however, that admirers will do funny and even sometimes peculiar things when attempting to attract the romantic partner once love-struck by that intoxicating cherub's arrow of desire. Oh, what we won't do for love.
For love, you've tried everything, but you won't give up. me do for love what I would not do. Make me do for love what I would not do.
Taking a closer look at the statistics, tomorrow, a little more than half of the U.S. population will have been struck by Cupid's arrow, and therefore will be out dining, perhaps by candlelight. But what about the other half? You know, the ones who didn't get popped by Cupid's trigger, or those who were just too shy to request a love duet by reciting the proverbial question, "Will you be my Valentine?"
One more chorus of our love duet. We keep trying, but we can't forget the thrill we feel from a love duet. Listen, baby, it ain't over yet. We got one more chorus of our love duet. We keep trying, but we can't forget the thrill we feel from a love duet. Listen, baby, it ain't over yet. We got one more chorus of our love duet.
Effective immediately, in the name of Cupido, and in support for all the reluctant romantic warriors, I'm unofficially proclaiming that any day can now be celebrated as Valentine's Day. On behalf of the folks here at Radio Laura, we hope you've enjoyed traveling with us to uncover these Valentine stories for food and music lovers. Now, don't forget, any day can be reserved for your special Valentine. And for those of you still searching for your own Mr. or Miss Right, Buon San Valentino. Happy Valentine's Day to you too. And don't worry, just keep right on searching.
We love-